In this lecture, we are going to look at the successors of King Alfred. King Alfred the Great, one of the last and one of the most powerful of the Wessex kings. Now, this is the kind of a flow chart which will take us through the House of Wessex, the important kings, and their reigns and how they were connected to each other. So this is the House of Wessex. We have King Alfred, the most important person to be remembered. He was followed by his son, Edward. Edward was King Alfred's son. Now Edward, he was able to push towards the north and the east up to River Humber, and he conquered the area that was occupied by the Danes. So we can see how the Kingdom of Wessex was getting bigger. So they are now reclaiming the areas that had been taken away by the Danes. So Edward contributed quite a lot to that. Now after Edward, you have his son, Æthelstan. Æthelstan was Edward's son, and he continued with the conquering spree. So he continued conquering till the last stronghold of Danish kingdom, that is towards the north, the Northumbria, the region called Northumbria. So the whole of Northumbria, everything now came under the House of Wessex, the Kingdom of Wessex. Now, after Æthelstan, his youngest brother, Edgar ascended the throne, because Æthelstan, though he had many sons, all of them died young. So he did not have children. So his youngest brother, Edgar, he ascended the throne. And the time period that he ruled over Britain is described as the golden age of the Saxons. He is called Edgar the Peaceful because of the peace, prosperity, culture, and civilization that he brought to the land for 16 years of his reign. Now, after Edgar the Peaceful, that is after his death, his stepson ascended the throne, because Edgar's own son, Edward, he was murdered by his stepmother, and she put her son, Æthelred, on the throne. So Æthelred is described as Æthelred the Unready. He was not really fit to be a king. He made a lot of mistakes. He took many decisions that were very foolish. So all these policy blunders that he committed was really bad for the kingdom. And ultimately, we will see how the land went into somebody else's hands. So for 32 years that Æthelred the Unready ruled the kingdom was marked with strife and uncertainty. So this is the House of Wessex. And when you're talking about Æthelred, technically, he does not share the bloodline of the House of Wessex, but then he's his stepson. Now here you have a couple of pictures. To the left you have a glass painting showing Edgar the Peaceful being crowned as the King of England by this priest, Archbishop of Canterbury, known as Saint Dunstan. He became a saint later. He was canonized later, so Dunstan. So there, this pair, Edgar and Dunstan, they were good friends. So you have a king being very friendly with a priest. So you have both politics as well as church ruling over the land in harmony. So this is considered to be a golden period, as well as you could say a perfect pair of a king and a priest. So this is the picture of Edgar the Peaceful, and here you have Saint Dunstan, and here you can see a stone inscription which shows that Edgar, he was the first king of all England. So please remember, by the time he came to the throne, more or less the whole of England was under the Wessex. So he can be considered as the first true king of the whole of England, and he was crowned by Dunstan, the Archbishop of Canterbury, in the Saxon Abbey on this site on Whitsunday, AD 973. So these are all proofs that these people existed and what had happened. Now, Edgar and Dunstan, when you're talking about Edgar and his rule, you cannot ignore the contribution of Saint Dunstan. So Edgar, he is considered as the first king of all of England, and it is considered to be the golden age of the Saxons. He was advised by his close friend Saint Dunstan. So he was his main advisor and a close friend. And who was Saint Dunstan? He was first the abbot of Glastonbury, then later bishop of Worcester and London, and finally he was the archbishop of Canterbury, a position which he held for 30 years. So for 30 years he was the archbishop of Canterbury. So even after the time of Edgar, Dunstan continued being the archbishop, and Edgar was on the throne for 16 years, please remember. And his spiritual counsel, this influenced the decisions and policies of King Edgar. So Dunstan can be considered as the first great clerical statesman of medieval England. And it is he who introduced the rule of Benedict in all the English monasteries. I hope you remember the Benedictine rule, obedience, poverty and chastity. So he introduced this to all the English monastery. It was made compulsory by this priest. And after this, you have Ethelred. We know after the death of Edgar the Peaceful, his stepson Ethelred ascended the throne. He is called Ethelred the Unready. So under his time, you have the threat of the Danes again. So you have the second Danish invasion. The first one was, if you remember, during Alfred and his brother, right? So now this is under him, Ethelred, you have the second Danish invasion, and he made a stupid decision. And what is this decision? He decided to pay off these invading Danes with a bribe. So he gave them a lot of money, and this money was collected by collected from the people. So there was this new tax levied upon the people called the Danegeld. Danegeld as in the money taken from the people, the tax taken from the people to pay off the Danish people. Earlier they had settled down peacefully under the Treaty of Wedmore. You remember all that, right? But now with a king who was not powerful and who was stupid, the Danes knew that this is the best time to attack. So now they were attacking again. So now what did the king do? He tried to pay them off by giving them money instead of fighting against them. And this money, this monetary, money was an invitation to loot more and to plunder more by the Danes. Earlier also they had come only with the sole purpose of looting, destroying and taking away resources. That was their only aim. So now they saw that the king was able to pay them so much of money. So this was an invitation for more attacks and plunders by the Danes. And what happened? Most of the Saxon cities, it fell to the Danes except for London. So till when you're talking about Edgar, you had more or less the whole of England under the Wessex kingdom. But now with this king, Ethelred, the kingdom was becoming smaller because the Danes were attacking and taking away almost all the major cities and major areas. So except for London, almost all the Saxon cities were invaded and defeated by the Danes. And when this was happening, the king did something foolish again. First was levying of this new tax called Danegeld. And second foolish decision was to massacre all the Danes who had settled peacefully in Wessex on St. Bryce's feast day in 1002. So this was a foolish decision. Why? Because these Danes, they were actually peaceful. They were not attacking. The ones who were attacking were the ones in Danelaw and even outside. They were the ones attacking. But the ones already settled in that particular area, they were very peaceful. So these, they had become citizens. So what did the king do? Foolishly, he ordered a massive massacre of all the Danes settled here. And this was a major bloodshed. And among the people who were murdered and massacred was a lady. And who was this lady? This lady was the sister of the King of Denmark. The King of Denmark at that time was Svein Forkbeard. Svein Forkbeard. So his sister was also a resident there in Wessex. She was living there. She was living there like a peaceful, ordinary citizen. So when this massacre was ordered, she also got killed. So now do you think the king of Denmark would keep quiet after knowing this, that his sister was murdered, massacred just like that, a peaceful person killed like that? So obviously he would come to take revenge, right? So now Ethelred so unwittingly invited this anger and wrath of Sweyn Fogbeard. So now King Sweyn Fogbeard of Denmark, he launched a very strong attack on England in revenge, because he was very angry because he had lost his sister because of this king's foolishness. Now King Ethelred, he knew that he was in trouble and he was not in a position to fight back. We had already seen how a weak king he was. So he fled, he ran for his life. He fled England in 1013. And where did he go? He took refuge in this place, Normandy in France. We are already familiar with Normandy. So he took refuge in Normandy. So why did he run to Normandy? Because his wife was the daughter of Richard, the Duke of Normandy. So his wife, Emma, was the daughter of Richard, the Duke of Normandy. So he ran away to England, leaving the kingdom and the people to their own devices and their own devices. So now what happened? England was without a king. England was without a king. So Sweyn Fogbeard, he brought his son Canute to rule England. So he brought his son Canute to rule England. So you have a Danish king coming and sitting on the throne of England, because English king had left the throne and he had run away for his dear life, the weak king that he was, Ethelred. So now, Ethelred, he ran away. But then he had this brave son, Edmund Ironside. So Edmund Ironside, who was Ethelred's son, he fought against the Danes, that is Canute. But then what happened? He was defeated. I mean, his might was not enough. It was not a match for Canute. So he was defeated by Canute. And after this, Ethelred also died. So you can see that bloodline came to an end there. So with that, you have the death of Ethelred also. And before that, his son Edmund had also died. So most of England now had no choice but to submit to the Danish king, Canute. So for the first time now on the throne of England, you have a Danish king called Canute. So you, here you have some pictures of Ethelred. You have Sweyn Fogbeard. Why is he called Fogbeard? Because his beard was kind of, you know, it looked like fork, a fork with the prongs. So his beard was styled and fashioned in that kind of a manner. So it used to look like a fork. So Sweyn Fogbeard, the king of Denmark. And here you have the picture of Canute, that is his son. So Ethelred was followed by Canute, who was a Danish king. So you have the picture of Canute now, and this is a picture of Emma. Now, who is Emma? Now, Canute, after becoming the king of England, he married the widow of Ethelred, Emma. So he married Emma. So that way, what was he doing? This was a marriage of, you could say, convenience, but at the same time, it also helped Canute to strengthen his rule over the English people, because now they were also happy with him because he married the widowed queen. So now Canute, the Danish king of England, he was also the ruler of all England, Denmark and Norway. So he had this whole, these, you know, different countries under him. And what kind of a person was he? He was a mature diplomat. And he married Emma, the widow of Ethelred. So you can see diplomacy at its highest here. And this helped him to enjoy the approval and support of the English people. They were happy because their widowed queen was married by the new king. So he was happy about it. And this king, he was very broad-minded and he was careful not to replace the traditions and practices of England. So he did not want to disturb the peace of the land. He did not want to disturb the lifestyle of the people. So this shows his maturity and his diplomacy. And he again confirmed Edgar the Peaceful's policy of letting the Danes and the Saxons following their respective laws and rules. So he did not interfere and muddle much into whatever was happening. That is, the Danes, they could continue with their laws and regulations, and the Saxons, they could follow whatever they were doing before. So he would be the king, he would rule over the land, but then he would not really get involved in the daily running of the land. And he was such a good man that history remembers him something like a demigod. So as good as a god. So he's revered as a demigod. There are so many mythical stories about him, about this king walking over water, this king providing things to poor people. All kinds of mythical stories are there about King Canute. So you can see how this foreigner, he came here, he was put on the throne by his father, right? But then how he became one of them, how he became very much like an English king, and how much he was loved by the people. And this person, Canute, he died in 1035, and he had three sons. So the kingdom was divided among these three sons. But then what happened? Their lives were cut short because they were wastrels given to a riotous living. So drinking and merrymaking, getting into duels and fights and things like that, because of which they lost their lives quite young. So all the sons died. So again, England was now without a king. Earlier, you know, Ethelred had run away and you had Canute coming in. Now after Canute, the sons, they proved really unworthy. So they all died quite young. So England was again without a king. Now after that, you have Edward the Confessor. You remember Ethelred had run away to France, right? He had run away to Normandy. He also had the son, his youngest son. He was proclaimed the king by the Withangamot. Now, what is a Withangamot? Withangamot is the council of elders. It's like a parliament. So it's like a parliament of wise men with representatives from the different rungs of society. So representatives from the lords, the earls. So all those people constituted the Withangamot, and their main responsibility was to advise the king. So now, in the absence of the king, this group, they decided and they proclaimed that Ethelred's youngest son would be the next king. So who was that? Edward. So Edward was brought back to England and he was made a king. And why is he called the Confessor? Because he was very much interested in spiritual affairs rather than the temporal and the material affairs. So he was more or less a spiritual kind of a person, given to religion, praying, meditation, that kind of a person. Now, after he became the king, after he was put on the throne of England, he had the support of the Danes also. Why? Because now what happened? His mother, Emma of Normandy, was also Canute's widow, right? So now this lady has been widowed twice. First, Ethelred's widow. Next, Canute's widow. So both the Saxon people as well as the Danish people, they approved and supported Edward as the king. So Edward did not have much difficulty. Now Edward, he had spent most of his life in Normandy. He grew up in Normandy in France. So obviously he had Norman friends. He was used to the Norman customs and traditions. So when he came to England, he brought all these French culture, friends, traditions and custom also into England. So now this led to the rise of two rival warring factions in the court. Because there was this group or this faction which consisted of the king and his band of Norman followers. Whereas there was another group of Saxons, true Saxons in the court. And because of which, you know, there was a lot of tension between these two factions or these two groups. So the Normans were patronized by the king, Edward. They had the support of the king because he himself was a Norman. Whereas the Saxons in the court, they were headed by Earl of Wessex. There was this Earl of Wessex called Godwin. Please remember the name, Earl of Wessex, Godwin. So Godwin, he was a very powerful lord. So all these Saxons, they rallied around Earl of Wessex, Godwin. So there were these two rival gangs in the court now trying to get power. So one was headed by the king and the other one was headed by Wessex, Godwin, a powerful lord. Now here is the picture painting of Edward the Confessor. So He is called a saint, even Edward the Confessor. So you can see a halo around his head. He's carrying a cross. So if you are not told that this is not a king, you would have mistaken this for the picture of a priest or some saintly person, right? So that was the kind of person that Saint Edward was. And this is Edith, his wife. Now we're going to see who Edward married and what kind of a marriage it was, and why do we have it here. Now, Edward and the Godwins, they shared a very uneasy relationship. We had already seen, right? There was this tension, this power struggle between these two groups or these two factions, the Normans versus the Saxons. So it was kind of a very uneasy, tensed relationship between Edward and the Godwins. So now what happened? The king was not that very strong initially, right? He was just learning the whole thing. He had come from France, so he was not very much used to the English way and the English, you know, the things that were happening. So now he was just learning. So what happened? Godwins, they were already very, very powerful. So now Godwins, they made the king, Edward, marry Edith, that is Godwin's daughter. So this was a very unhappy marriage, and the king was really irritated about the whole thing, but he had no choice but to marry. So he was just biding his time. He was waiting for the time when he'll be able to take revenge on the Godwins and throw them out of the country. He was biding his time. So this opportunity came in the form of a disobeyal on the part of Godwin. So once God, this King Edward had given some command to Edward. So now what happened? Godwin's, that is Godwin, he disobeyed this particular command. He was supposed to take care of somebody and, you know, leave somebody somewhere. And what happened? He misbehaved with the king's guests. So that led to a feud, a kind of a sword battle. So this was a kind of an insult to the king. So now king made use of this particular opportunity. So that particular thing, that was a chance for the king to get rid of this troublesome Godwins. So king was helped by the earls of Northumbria and Mercia, and they prepared for a civil war against Godwin. But now Godwin had no support, nothing, because these earl of Northumbria, Mercia, and Edward, they all had joined forces against him. So now Godwin, he surrendered. He said sorry. So now what was the punishment given to the Godwins? Godwin and his family, they were exiled. And what happened to his wife, Edith, that is Godwin's daughter? She was sent off to a convent in Wiltshire. So the king happily sent her away to a convent to lead the life of a nun. So it was kind of annulling the marriage. So he ended his marriage with this lady. So now after this, Edwin, King Edward, he consolidated. I've written Edwin here. That's actually a mistake. It should be Edward. Edward, he consolidated his power as the King of England. Now Godwin's had gone, so that threat was no more there. And that unhappy marriage also came to an end. So he was very happy now. So finally he took control of the land, and finally he showed the people who is the real ruler of the land. And he had a close friend in the Archbishop of Canterbury called Robert, so he was quite close to him. And it is under his time the Westminster Abbey was built, under Edward's time. Edward and Robert, so they overtook this building of the Westminster Abbey. Now, we know that how Edward was close to his French relations and French friends. So there was this kind of a Norman atmosphere in this English kingdom, English court, because many of the courtiers were Frenchmen who had actually tagged along and come with the king. So now this inspired many visits from the Normans in France. So this was like a mini French court where in Britain under King Edward the Confessor. So this was kind of an inviting atmosphere for many of the French people. So many Normans kept visiting people And then there were, it was kind of a two-way thing. Many of these people, they went to went to meet their people in Normandy, and many people from Normandy would come to France. So now there was one person, William. Please remember the name, William, the Duke of Normandy. He also visited. He was also very friendly with Edward. Please remember that this person was an illegitimate son of Robert, the Duke of Normandy, and he was not related to King Edward. So no relation of King Edward. There was no relation. He was an illegitimate son of Robert. But then William, Duke of Normandy, was a very powerful lord there. Very, very powerful. More powerful than the King of France itself. So he was that kind of a man. He was an illegitimate son of this, Duke of Normandy, Robert. So now Edward, he admired William so much, because Edward was not this statesman and this political star. He was not that, right? So he really admired William's ability. William, this very, very dashing duke, he really admired him. So during one of their talks, what happened? He confided in William about his decision to make William his successor, because Edward had no children. So in one of their talks, maybe they were having drinks or something, he said that after me, you will be the king of England. So he said something of that kind. So you can understand now what would have happened to William of Normandy. So so these seeds were already sown in the minds of William, that one day he would sit on the throne of England, because Edward, he had no children. He had no children, so obviously there would be some kind of a confusion, and somebody had to be made the next king. So he confided in William that he had plans to make him his successor. And this is the picture of William of Normandy. He's called William the Conqueror. We'll see why. And here you have a statue wherein you can see him sitting there. He has a sword in his hand, and there is a book in his hand called the Domesday Book, which we will be doing in detail in the coming classes. So this is the picture of William of Normandy, the Conqueror. Take a good look at him, because we cannot ignore him. So he's going to be one of the future rulers of the land. So now this man already had in his mind this desire to sit on the throne of England, especially after this idea was planted in his mind by Edgar. So now, after the death of Edgar, what would happen? There were many claimants to the throne of England. One was William of Normandy. We already seen that, right? He had this thing in his mind that he would be the next king. There was another gang led by the Godwins. Earl Godwin, though they had been exiled, they were also biding their time and planning to come back to England and claim the throne. So you had the Godwins. So Earl Godwin and his son Harold Godwin. So now these people, they attacked England with the help of Flemish army and Kent. Flemish army, as in Flemish is Flanders. Flanders is a region to the northern side of England, right? Northern side of France. So these people, they exiled and they were living there in Flanders near France. So now they got the support of the Flemish army and also army from Kent. So with their help, Harold Godwin and Earl Godwin, they came and attacked the land. So now what happened? When the attack happened, Edward was there. So this was towards the last phase of Edward's rule. So Edward was forced to get into a peace pact with the Godwins. Now Godwins were back in power, and after this, the senior Godwin, the father Godwin, he died, and after that, his son Harold was made the next Earl of Wessex, and he continued in Wessex as a deputy to King Edward. So he was a very nice gentleman. The son, unlike the father, he was a much better person, a much better character. So he was a very able deputy to the King Edward, and he helped King Edward to fight against the invading Welsh people also. So because of this, now people also were looking forward to Godwin, Harold Godwin, to be the king after Edgar's death, because he was already now like a deputy. So you have William of Normandy is taking the claim. Then you have the Godwins taking the claim. Later, his own son Harold Godwin becoming a deputy to the king. So obviously, he also had a legitimate claim to the throne of England. And the third party that laid a claim to the throne of England was Harald Hardrada of Norway. Now, Harald Hardrada, the king of Norway, why did he stake his claim? Because earlier, if you remember, Norway was also a part of Canute's empire, Canute the Danish king, right? So that was also under Canute. So now, England was once upon a time Canute's empire, right? Canute's kingdom. So based on that logical argument, Harald Hardrada of Norway also staked his claim to the throne of England. So you have three parties already. Now the fourth was the Welsh. So now the Welsh people were also trying to invade England, and their leader was Gruffydd, a person called Gruffydd. So you already have England teeming with so many claimants, so many claimants to the throne of England after the time of Edward the Peaceful. So here you have the picture, the coronation of Harold Godwin. So Harold Godwin, he was appreciated and loved by everyone. Unlike his father, he was a gentleman. And once what happened, he was caught in a shipwreck when he was going to Normandy. So off the coast of Normandy in France, he was caught in a shipwreck. So he was captured and he was brought to the king, William. Now, William, you remember, right? William of Normandy. So he was taken to William of Normandy. So these two men, they developed a very nice friendship between Harold Godwin and William. So now the king, he made Harold Godwin to swear the oath of fealty to William. That is, Godwin will always be faithful to him even after becoming the king of England, because he was one of the prospective candidates to be the next king after the death of the king on the throne, right? So now William made him swear that he would continue to be loyal to this man in Normandy. And he actually, Harold Godwin, owed his life to William, because he was rescued from that shipwreck and he was captured and he was left free by William. So now, after the death of Edward, he became the king. Who? Harold Godwin. He became the king of England in 1066. So after he became the king, what happened? William was really unhappy. Though he had been very friendly with Harold Godwin, he was very unhappy. He did not accept Harold's succession as the king of England. And why was this so? Because he had in his mind, based on the promise that was given by Edgar the Peaceful, that one day he would sit on the throne of England. So he had this ambition, this desire to be the king of England. So he was not willing to accept Harold as the king of England. So now he wanted to attack England. So before that, what happened? These Norwegians, if you remember, Harald Hardrada, Norwegians under Harald Hardrada, they attacked the northern region of England. So you have so too many people and too many gangs staking their claim for the throne. So now Norwegians under Harald Hardrada, they attacked the northern region of England. So now English army under Harold Godwin, they went towards the northern region and they were fighting Harold Hardrada. And when they were away in the northern region, England was attacked from the southern region by William of Normandy, because he refused to accept Harold as the king. So now Harold Godwin, they were in the northern region, please remember. So now Harold Godwin, he defeated the Norwegians under Harald Hardrada in the Battle of Stamford Bridge on September 25, 1066, end of September. And at the same time, I think by the first week of November or so, William had landed on the southern shore of England. So there was hardly any gap. They did not have even time enough to rest and they had to rush, who? Godwin and the English army. They had to rush to Hastings. Now, Hastings is in the southern region, southern border of England. So they had to come to Hastings, where William's army was stationed. And William's army, they had all the time in the world. They got plenty of rest and they were really prepared. So it was a battle between uneven forces. On one hand, you have Harold, Godwin, and his army, who were really tired after this battle of Stamford Bridge, which they did, which they had won. But then they're human beings, right? But they didn't have enough time to rest. Immediately after that particular victory, they had to rush back to the southern region of England, where these people were staying put, William and his army. And there was a battle. And the battle was called the Battle of Hastings. And this happened in October 1066. And in this battle, what happened? Harold Godwin and his brothers, they were defeated and they died in the battle. So they died the death of a brave, honorable gentleman. He died the death of a brave warrior, who? Harold Godwin. So with that, we have the end of the House of Godwins. So there were no sons after that. So with that, this bloodline of the House of Godwins come to an end. Here you have a map showing us this Battle of Hastings, the Norman conquest of England. So what do we see here? This is Stamford Bridge, right? So now Harald Hardrada, the Norwegian fleet, they came from this region, from Norway, and they attacked England here. Stamford Bridge. So London, now this was the center, right? So this was their center, the kingdom, the court, everything. So from here, King Harold Godwin and his army, they marched all the way to this northern region where the battle was fought. The battle was fought on September 25, 1066, called the Battle of Stamford Bridge. And in that battle, Harold Godwin, he defeated Harald Hardrada. So they were victors. And after that, they had to come back. They had to come back to London. They had to come back to this main area. But before that, they didn't have enough time to come back in peace. They did not have time to rest. Because before that, on 28th of September, William of Normandy, he landed here. He landed in Hastings. So just 3 days, 28th, just 3 days in that gap, he came and landed here. William of Normandy. So now these people, they had to hurry without resting or anything. They had to hurry. They had to come back. They had to come back to Hastings to put up a defense against William of Normandy. So it was a battle of uneven strength, because though they were strong, everything, Harold Godwin and his men, they were really tired. They had not rested. And what happened in this Battle of Hastings? They lost their lives. They were killed. I mean, all these people, that is King Harold and his army, they fought to the very last, and their army, they tried their best to save their king. But then he was hit by an arrow on his face or something, and he dropped dead in the battlefield itself. So with that, you have, and even he had younger brothers. They were also killed in the same battle. So with this battle, you have the end of the House of Godwin. So all of them were dead, and this whole bloodline, this whole family came to an end. So now, after that, this Battle of Hastings was won by William of Normandy, or we call him William the Conqueror. All right, so once again, you have a foreign king now sitting on the throne of England. So you have a French man coming, staking the claim, and sitting on the throne of England. So in this class, what we have done is we have seen the successors of King Alfred, and ultimately how the Saxon bloodline, the House of Wessex, came to an end. And later, we also find the House of Godwins coming to an end. And with the Battle of Hastings in 1066, which is another important milestone, you have the Norman conquest of England. And the throne of England going to a person from France.